Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
So it's wonderful to be here amongst all of you today. And I'll speak on the first verse of the Mukunda Mala Stotra. And I'll speak this, the essential message of the verse, using an acronym. So the first verse is a prayer which invokes the mood of the stotra. Mukunda Mala Stotra is a composition by Shri Kulashekhar. He's one of the Alvars, one of the greatest saints in the Bhakti tradition in South India, the Shri Vaishnava tradition. And we will try to understand through this verse how God acts in our life, how God's blessings come in our life. So I'll talk about, use the word bull. The word animal bull is considered a very powerful animal, most powerful among domestic animals. And that's why Purusha Rishabha. Rishabha is a bull amongst men. Arjuna is glorified as something like Purusha Rishabha. So B-U-L-L. So blessings are understood by linking with the liberator. So what is a blessing? How can we understand the Lord's blessings? These are the 4 points based on the 4 lines of this verse that I'll talk. So the verse is Shri Vallabheti Vardeti Daya Pareti Bhakta Priyeti Bhavalundhana Kovideti Natheti Nagashayaneti Jagannivaseti Alapinam Kutidinam Kuruma Mukunda. So Shri Vallabheti Vardeti Daya Pareti. This is describing the glories of the Lord. It says, He is the Lord of the Goddess of Fortune. Shri Vallabheti. Normally everybody loves fortune, but the Goddess of Fortune loves the Lord. Fortune is fickle and it comes and goes, but she stays always with the Lord. So she is the lover, she loves the Lord. Shri Vallabheti. And He doesn't keep His fortune with Himself. He gives the fortune profusely to others. Varadeti. He can bless us. But His blessings are not ordinary. They are transcendental. Daya pareti. Daya is there. There is mercy, compassion. Blessings are there. But pareti. Para means it is beyond. Transcendent means that which goes beyond the ordinary. So His blessings are not ordinary. They are extraordinary. Now, what do we mean by extraordinary blessings? The first line talks about blessings. And the Lord is the blesser. But how does He bless? What makes His blessings daya pareti, extraordinary? Because bhavalantana kovideti shivallabheti vardeti daya pareti bhakta priyeti bhavalantana kovideti bhakta priyeti. He loves His devotees. The devotees love Him and He loves the devotees. And therefore, what does He do? Bhava lunthana kovideti. Kovida is expert. Bhava is material existence. Lunthan is to plunder, to destroy. So sometimes, a negative word is used to describe something which is very positive. It's like we might say, this happens with words also, that you have heard the word wicked. Among teenagers, the word wicked is used in a positive sense. Oh, that was a wicked match. You heard that? So there are some words which I was in London. I'd gone to Leicester actually, and I had a college program, and a very good question answers after that. The organizer was very happy after the question answers, and he said that actually, after that, with a big smile, he came to me and he says, "You killed it." What? Who did I kill? I was alarmed. And then he had such a bright smile on his face. He's telling I'm a murderer, and he said, "You killed." The smile on his face. So then, afterward, I understood that kill is a term drawn from hunting. Somebody shoots very well and kills. So you killed it is well done. It's a way of saying that. Now, killing is considered very negative, but you killed it is considered a positive thing. So similarly, here, luntan is plunder. So, but bhavaluntana kovideti, that the Lord is expert in plundering the material existence of his devotees. Now, what does it mean? That means that he, because he loves us, he wants us to be with him. And whatever keeps us attached to the world, whatever keeps us in this world, he's expert at removing all those attachments. So now, that's what daya pareti. His blessing is ordinary blessing would be that we give, see, all that we have in the world we can offer him is material. The only non-material thing that we can offer him is our heart. And otherwise, we have our wealth, we have our time, we have our energy, we have our contacts. There are many ways in which we can offer our heart's devotion to him. But basically, we offer him something material essentially. It's our heart we want to offer, but we express that to something material. And he can also give something material. But he doesn't reciprocate only at that level. We offer him the temporary and he gives us something eternal. We offer him the temporary things of this world and he gives us the eternal thing, eternal love for him. And but to give the eternal, he has to make space in our heart. If our heart is filled with the temporary, then we cannot get the eternal. So therefore, Bhavaluntana Kovideti is expert at plundering the material existence of those who are devoted to him. So blessings are understood. The second part of the blessings have to be understood. Some blessings are easy to understand. We want something and we get it. That's a blessing. We pray to God and we get it. But sometimes he blesses in a way that is not so easy to understand. And Natheti Nagashayaneti Jagannivasetya, that he is the eternal shelter of everyone. He's the Nath, he's the Lord, he's the parent of everyone. Natheti Nagashayaneti. Now, Nagashayaneti is at one level a describer of his eternal pose. He reclines on Anantashesh. But it also indicates, now a snake is considered to be dangerous. And nobody will, if what to speak of reclining on a snake. If you are reclining on our bed and there is a snake below, we will jump off. So, that which is dangerous, that which will make us flee away, the Lord comfortably reclines in that. So everything that is dangerous for us, none of that is dangerous for him. So he is our eternal master. Nagashayaneti. Whatever causes us danger, none of it causes him danger. He is safe, he is transcendental, and he can make us safe and transcendental. Jagannivasetya. Why does he? Jagannivasetya, the shell. The whole world resides within him. That means everything in this world is ultimately in his control. It exists within him, and therefore there is no danger for us because of anything in this world. So basically, there is no danger for him, and if we link with him. So the whole point is that we are already linked with him because he's already our Lord. We are present in the universe and the universe is present within him. So we are already linked with him. But we need to realize that link. By linking with whom? Alapinam pratidinam kurma mukunda. Mukunda, the liberator. We link with him by chanting his names. Alapinam. Recite his names. Pratidinam. Every day. Just recite his names. Now the reciting of the names is basically to trigger our remembrance. Among all living beings, humans have the power of speech and language. And especially in terms of communicating through various languages and through writing. And it's through writing and language that scriptural knowledge is also given to us. So the power of articulation is very great, it's very distinctive. And this power, if used spiritually, can take us toward liberation. So chanting is not just the uttering of mantras, It is using the power of our, the distinctive power of articulation that we all have to link with the divine, to offer our devotion to the Lord. So this is the summary of the verse broadly, that we'll talk about this now. The blessings are understood by linking with the liberator. So normally, different people have different conceptions of God. If at all, people have any conception. Some people, they just don't care whether God exists or not. I was giving a seminar, where was it, in Kannada. So they wanted me to speak of something scientific. So does God exist? They asked me to speak. Then after that, I talked with them. And then one of the organizers said, actually, they changed the title of the seminar. And they said, if God exists, so what? The hat, how does it matter? How does it matter? I was at an interfaith panel discussion in Australia. And the topic of that discussion was, why hasn't God died till now? What that meant was that Friedrich Nietzsche was a famous German philosopher, and he said, God is dead. Now, when he said that, what he meant was that not that God, of course, if he exists, he's eternal. He can't die. But the basis for society to believe in God, that has died. So the idea of God has died. He thought that because of the advancement of science, belief in God has become untenable. So many sociologists have predicted from the middle of the 19th century that as science progresses, religion will decline and religion will die. But there has been a remarkable resurgence in religion all over the world. America is one of the world's most religious countries, especially among the developed world, first world countries. The Middle East is religious, India is religious. So many of the parts of the world are religious. So why is God not died till now? That was the theme. What is the reason for the remarkable staying power of religion? So the point I was making is different people have different conceptions of God. And depending on our conception, we perceive what is a blessing and what is not a blessing. So we all at some time in our life feel the need for help beyond our power. We all, whatever powers we have talents, we have resources, we have discipline, we all use that to achieve whatever is important for us. But even when we are trying to do that, at some time or the other we understand that the results don't depend on me alone. And there are so many factors beyond me that shape the results. And therefore, we start beseeching whatever is out there. Recently, when the Cricket World Cup was going on, I was in Australia at that time. And one of my friends, he had gone to London for the World Cup. And as the India-Pakistan match was there at that time. And before that, many matches were wiped out because of rains. So he had bought a ticket for the India-Pakistan match, and that one ticket was £1,000. £1,000 is about 1 lakh. 1 lakh in INR for one match. And he called me and he said, you know, I don't believe in God, but still you pray to God that match doesn't get cancelled. Otherwise I lose 1 lakh rupees. Now BCCI has a policy that if there is not a single ball bowled, then they will refund. But they will refund to the person who has bought the ticket at the rate that they sold it. But he had bought the ticket in black. So he would hardly get much. So even if we are interested in sports, we recognize that there are so many factors beyond our control. And there may be something unknown which controls things. And that's how we turn towards God and we think of praying. And when we pray for something and we get it, that's what we normally consider as a blessing. So if somebody is sick and the doctor says iffy whether we can cure it or not, then you pray to God. And then if the disease is cured, you say, oh, God is blessed. So normally, this is the understanding of our normal understanding of blessings. That we form a relationship with God, and the terms of the relationship are that my intelligence and your power. I have this problem, I know what is the solution to this problem, but I just can't do it. So you use your power and you do the solution. So when we pray to God, often this is the way we approach. And that's how sometimes even atheists, they like to serve God. But they like to serve God only in one role, as advisors. They will say, if God had existed, he should not have made it like this. He should have made this like this. So, their term of the relationship is, I know better than God. And because things are not done the way I think they should be done, therefore, God doesn't exist or God is not good. Whichever way. So now this is, now of course, we do have intelligence and we are meant to use our intelligence. But humility allows us to recognize that we don't know everything about reality. And if we don't know everything about reality, that means that the same thing that may seem at one level very bad for us, but that might be actually good for us. Say if we are walking along the road and suddenly we see a big hefty man charging towards us with hands upraised and yelling loudly. What happened? What did I do to provoke this person? And the person charges towards us and is charging so fast we can't even run, we don't know what to do. And the person charges right toward us and then goes by us and bang, we hear something. And we look back and we see there was a thief with a deadly weapon charging toward us from behind. And this person was warning us. This person is coming. But they were speaking in a different language. And we thought the person was attacking us. Whereas his intention was actually to protect us. So, with our limited knowledge, sometimes we see some danger coming towards in our life. But who knows? Maybe what seems dangerous to us is actually protecting us from some other danger. So, blessings can sometimes be understood in terms of the fulfillment of what we seek. But sometimes blessing can come in an entirely opposite way. So that's why blessing need to be understood. That bhavaluntanako videti. That sometimes the Lord takes away that which is dear to us. The idea here is that our consciousness is meant to evolve. If you could say that small babies, and if you want to say positively, they're just unaware of anything except themselves. Now, a newborn baby doesn't even understand that this is my mother. You don't understand that this I'm drinking from my mother milk. This is something soft and I get something nice from it. But so we could say they do not have any awareness of anything except themselves. As they grow, as the baby grows, I start getting aware, okay, this is my mother, this is another person. So, a baby basically may cry anytime, maybe at midnight. Now, if an adult, if say maybe a 10-year-old, 12-year-old boy starts crying at the night, what is this? You consider inappropriate, isn't it? Because they have greater awareness. Yeah, everyone is sleeping. Don't cry loudly. Don't make a lot of noise. So what happens? That as we grow older, our consciousness expands. So that we become more aware of the things and the people around us. And this expansion of consciousness is meant to grow till we ultimately become aware of God. Say in the past, maybe 100, 200 years ago, we were aware only that this earth is meant for our enjoyment. So let's industrialize, let's deforest. But now we become more aware. Actually, this earth has its own harmony, its own balances, and we can't disrupt it. That's why there is an increasing rise in environmental consciousness. So what is happening? To some extent, the consciousness is expanding. So just as our consciousness expands naturally as we grow biologically, similarly, our consciousness is meant to expand as we grow spiritually. And ultimately, we are meant to become conscious of Krishna. So for a child who is very attached to oneself, as the child grows up, becomes attached to the mother. That means attached to the mother means if child does something, it looks at the mother. And the mother frowns.
I should not do this.
And the mother smiles. Oh, and child does it. So child wants to please the mother. So what has happened? The consciousness has expanded. So similarly, for us, our consciousness is to expand. Now, expansion of consciousness, especially to understand God and how God works, that is not easy. It's just like if there's a small baby, maybe 2-3 years old, and you tell the baby, clean your room. Tell the child, clean your room. Now for us, cleaning the room is a very simple thing. Okay, put this here, clean it. But if you think about it, cleaning your room is actually an abstract conception, which has many concrete things, isn't it? So maybe the way you clean the kitchen, that means okay, you put this here, put that there. The way you clean your library might be very different. Clean the kitchen means maybe you use water for that. But if you decide to use water in the library, it's going to be terrible. So the point I'm making here is that when we is what we consider simple, clean your room. It actually contains many different concrete actions in different situations. So cleaning is a in one sense, of course, it's a tangible action, but cleaning your room, it's a, like an abstract conception, and it can contain different things. So if a child has to be told, clean your room, the child can't process it. And then the mother tells the child, okay, you see the toy over there? Go and pick it up. The child goes and picks it up. Child looks at the mother and she smiles. Oh, he also feels happy. Okay. Now you take it and put it on that rack. Oh, not there. Put it next to the other toy. Oh, don't put it fallen down. Keep it vertical. Does it look good now? Oh, it's good. Now you take the shoes and put it on the shoe rack. Now you take that cloth, you take that pillow, and put it on that side of the bed. So, what is happening is that concept of cleaning has to be explained in terms of concrete actions. And then the child understands. So, what is very straightforward for the mother may not be straightforward for the child. And there has to be a communication of that. So now, similarly for us, the way God acts and the way we act, there are two different levels. And now at one level, Krishna explains through scripture. But we also need to study the scripture to understand it. So Krishna's blessings come in the form that he wants our consciousness to expand. And at one level, instead of being self-centered, I was giving a class in New Zealand, and I often speak about how in the Western world the social foundations are crumbling, how the divorce rate is going up. So then one devotee told me, you can't speak this over here. I said, why? He said, because divorce rates are not going down over here. Sorry, divorce rates are not going up over here. Really? How come? These marriage rates are going down. So now, at one level, if somebody is self-obsessed, is doing whatever they want, then if they at least become responsible, committed enough to form a steady relationship with someone instead of just living in or having casual indulgences, then that requires the expansion of consciousness. It requires a significant amount of coming out of self-obsession to sustain the relationship. And then if parents have a child, then they have to further expand their consciousness. So each of these is an expansion of consciousness. But sometimes, our consciousness expands up to a particular point and stops up there. Now, Krishna wants our consciousness to keep expanding. So, if the consciousness stops at a particular point, then it is an attachment. Wherever the consciousness stops, it gets blocked over there. That's an attachment. There's a difference between attachment and commitment. Commitment is the investment of emotion, the investment of consciousness. Attachment is the imprisonment of consciousness. It is the imprisonment of emotion. When we are invested in someone, we are concerned about them. But we are not imprisoned by that. So we have relationships, and every relationship is important for us. But we see that ultimately, whatever we are doing for anyone in any relationship, or whatever anyone is doing for us, it is not just that person doing to us, it is Krishna doing through that person to us. For example, on the most intimate and selfless acts of love is a mother breastfeeding her child, a newborn child. Now, that certainly requires a deep amount of intimacy. At the same time, when the child is born, it's not that the mother does anything special to produce milk in her breast. The same God who sent a child through the womb into the world also arranged for milk in the mother's breast. So the idea here is that yes, it is the mother's love, but it is not only the mother's love. It is God's love coming through the mother's love. So we need to, of course, recognize the medium, the instrument through which the love is coming. But we also need to recognize the source behind that. So if we just get caught in the instrument, then it is an attachment. But if we see the instrument, we see the channel, and then we see the source, then that attachment, that won't be an attachment, it's a commitment, but we move forward also toward Krishna. So for each one of us, I'm explaining all this as Bhava Lunthana Koviteti. The Lord is expert in plundering our material existence. That means that wherever our consciousness gets locked, Krishna disrupts that.
What is the meaning
of Kovida? Kovida is expert. Expert. Krishna is expert in Lunthana, plunder. In plundering our material existence. So, that means wherever our consciousness gets locked, Krishna disrupts that. Now sometimes, because our consciousness is locked in that, we think, okay, this disturbance is there, Krishna, please restore this, please make this right. And that's what, if Krishna makes it right, we think Krishna is very good. Krishna answers my prayers. But if that doesn't happen, then you think, what is going on? Why is Krishna not answering my prayers? Like, what I'm asking, what is happening is the opposite of that. So now the purpose of Krishna is not to disrupt our life. The purpose of Krishna is to disrupt that which is interrupting our progress in life. So whenever anything which is dear to us is disturbed, we shouldn't see that as God rejecting us or God not caring for us. Actually, God cares for us, and that's why He cares what we care for us. And if that is restricting us, sometimes He'll disrupt us. Not that He will take it away, but that He will force us to think bigger. What does think bigger mean over here? So, all this we're talking about, blessings need to be understood. And how do we understand the blessings? By linking with the liberator. Linking with the liberator means what? That ultimately, we have various relationships, we have various responsibilities, but ultimately, our relationship is with Krishna. That relationship is eternal. And that responsibility of connecting with Krishna is our most important responsibility. If that is interrupted, that is impeded, then that is against our eternal spiritual well-being. So what Krishna does sometimes is that He forces us to link with Him. Whatever it is that we are attached to, that also becomes our shelter to some extent. But when that attachment is shaken, that shelter is shaken, then we have to expand our consciousness. Think of something beyond. And that's how we turn toward Krishna. That's how, so we link with Him. So Krishna can give us many blessings, but Krishna is Krishna's greatest blessing. Krishna is Krishna's greatest blessing. That means, if we turn toward Him, we make Him our shelter, He becomes our supreme attachment. He becomes our supreme object of love. That is our ultimate shelter. So, now how do we link with the liberator? I'll use one example to illustrate this point, and then we can have some question answers. See, there is a bird. And the bird is a small bird who has not yet fully developed its wings. The wings are there, but the bird has not actually flown. And now the bird has to fly. But the bird is secure on a branch and doesn't fly. And then suddenly the branch under it starts shaking. And then the branch starts breaking. Now the bird will be like, oh, let this branch become steady, let this branch become steady. But no. Now if the bird is about to crash, then it starts flapping its wings. And it flaps its wings, and as it flaps its wings, what happens? It's able to fly. It has never flown before. So it can't fly for long. But it's flapping its wings. And then it's on this branch here, and this branch starts breaking. And it flaps its wings and goes here. And gets to the branch over there. That's all it has. But it gets from this branch to that branch. So, it would never have flapped its wings and flown if the branch had not broken. So, for all of us, whatever we are attached to, that is like the branch under us. And it's important for us. But sometimes the branch breaks or threatens to, it appears that it's going to break. And our wings are our devotion, our connection with Krishna, our attachment to Krishna, our intuition to connect with Krishna. So, we often don't focus on connecting with Krishna till the branch under us breaks. When everything in our life is fine, then, yes. I mean, I started practicing bhakti. I was talking about bhakti with my uncle. He says, yes, I believe in God. He's happy there and I'm happy here. Yes, we will be happy here, but our happiness is like a bird on a branch. The branch will break sometime. So then, when the branch breaks, that's when we are forced to flap our wings. Now, sometimes we don't flap our wings and we just crash down. So if we don't take shelter of Krishna, if we don't grow spiritually at that time, we will sink into greater and greater suffering, greater and greater distress. We see nowadays, so many people suffering from depression, mental health problems. Now, of course, there can be many different causes for this. But at one level, it is because people have lost a spiritual orientation. Because there is no ultimate meaning in life. But there is no idea also that there is some ultimate meaning in life. So whatever gives them meaning, if it collapses, then what am I to do? What is my life made for? They sink into depression. If for them everything is maybe scoring well in their exams or maybe having a relationship with someone, and if that crumbles, then they feel my life itself has no meaning. My exist that maybe I am worthless. So we all need that ultimate connection. And if we don't have that connection, if we don't develop that connection, then we crash downward. So blessings are understood by linking with the liberator. The breaking of the branch is not a blessing. But sometimes the breaking of the branch is necessary for us to discover the blessing of our wings. So bad things happen and they are bad. We don't say that bad things are good. That bad things are bad, definitely. But sometimes those bad things force us to turn toward God. Force us to take shelter of Him more. And that shelter that we experience in Him, that is the ultimate blessing. So, we link with the liberator. The liberator means what? The bird that is stuck on the branch is liberated when its wings develop. So similarly for each one of us, our attachments at one level shelter us, but another level they also fetter us, they also bind us, they also imprison us. So when we become liberated from them, that is the time when we can move freely in life. Whatever life sends our way, it is the shelter of Krishna that helps us to face it, to go through it, and to grow through it. So, Krishna is Mukunda. He is the liberator. He is, the world has distresses in many different ways. God is not the cause of the distress. God is the cure for the distress. But as long as we expect that relief from the distress in our own terms, we don't understand this. Instead, if we become open to understanding that Krishna is actually eternal, and therefore that Krishna is eternal, I am eternal. So whatever might look very bad in the short term, through that, Krishna will help me gain something in the long term. Through a material adversity, Krishna may take me toward spiritual prosperity. And with that faith when we live, then we will find that it says Arjuna has become Purusha Shabha, has become like a bull among men. So we also, bull among human beings, we will also become strong. Now we will be surprised to discover how strong devotion can make us to face life storms and to go through them and to grow through them. So I'll summarize what I spoke today. I spoke on this theme of how we need to understand Krishna's blessings. Blessings are understood by linking with the liberator. So I talked about the Mukunda Mala Stotra. So Shri Vallabeti Varadeti Daya Pareti. So he's the blesser, he's the Lord of the Goddess of Fortune, he is the giver of good fortune. But he is the giver of transcendental good fortune. That means we think of blessings that we, if we, he gives out of the ordinary blessings. We give something material, something temporary, and he can give us something temporary. But he gives us something eternal. And sometimes to give the eternal, he has to take away the temporary, he has to disrupt the temporary. So blessings need to be understood. Understood is, he is bhakta priyeti bhavalundhana kobiteti. He loves the devotees, therefore he takes away whatever is taking the devotee away from him. He is expert at plundering the material existence of the devoted. So here plunder is used in a positive sense. It's like kill. You kill. It's used in a positive sense. So when we say it's plundering, it is not that he wants to cause us distress. You have the example of how different things operate at different levels. Just like a person might seem to be attacking us, but actually the person is attacking the one who is attacking us. Or the mother might say, clean the house. But the child is not at the not conceptually evolved enough to understand it. So it needs to be step by step broken and understood. So similarly, when we approach God and think that God blesses us when we form the relationship in terms of my intelligence and your power. So that's also good, at least we are going to God. We are aware that there is some power beyond me and I need to appease it, to satisfy it, to get what I want. So God can bless us in that way also. He blesses us that way. But sometimes he blesses us not according to our intelligence, what is best for us, but according to his intelligence. And at that time, instead of obsessing over why something is not happening the way we want it, we try to expand our consciousness. Naturally, our consciousness expands from infancy, when the child is just obsessed with oneself. From the complete self-absorption to awareness of others. That's how the child grows. And this growth is meant to ultimately take us to Krishna. But during this expansion, we might get locked in something. So every relationship at one level is good because it gets our consciousness out of ourselves. But if we get caught in that relationship, then it is not commitment but attachment. Attachment means our emotions are imprisoned. Commitment means our emotions are invested. So if something becomes a prison, imprisons our consciousness and our emotions, and Krishna may disrupt that. So at that time, Krishna can give us various blessings, but Krishna is Krishna's greatest blessing. So when the blessings are not understood, we need to link with the liberator. Link. Natheti nagashayaneti jagan nivasetya. But he's already our master. He's already the shelter within whom we are existing. And even the greatest dangers of the world are no danger to him. He reclines on the snakes. So when we link with him, that means basically when the branch under us breaks, we spread our wings. The spreading of the wings, rising based on the wings, is the development of our devotional inclination. So sometimes our material shelter is shaken, and that forces us to turn toward the Lord. Of course, if we have no knowledge or inclination to turn toward the Lord, then we'll crash down. And that's what is happening when people are psychologically crumbling, because they don't have any spiritual vision which gives ultimate meaning to their lives. Then he is ultimately the liberator. Alapinam pratidinam gurumam mukunda. Mukunda. He is, that says, the bird might be comfortable on the branch, but it is bound to the branch if its wings are not developed. The breaking of the branch liberates the bird by forcing it to develop its wings. So Krishna forces us to get our consciousness out of the things in which it is trapped. And his purpose is that we see the channel through which whatever we are getting. If the mother's love is there, mother feeding the child. But it is also God's love who has provided the mother with the breast milk. So we see beyond the channel to the source. And in that way, if we link with Krishna, then no matter whatever difficulties will come in our life, that connection with Krishna will transform that material adversity into spiritual prosperity. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Are there any questions or comments? Yes, ma'am. When we start practicing bhakti and pursue eternal life, we also want our family members to pursue that, and sometimes that makes us more attached to them. So should we also give up that attachment? I think what you are talking about is not so much attachment as expectation. It's just like we expect, say we have our children, then all parents expecting from our children, we may expect that they do well in their studies, they develop good habits, but then we also expect them to practice bhakti. And if you don't, then it becomes like we feel agitated with that, is not happening. So yeah, you could say that our expectations from others increase. And of course, we are expecting something for their good only. But still, our expectations increase. And see, if in general, frustration is proportional to expectation. The more we expect, the more we get frustrated. So there are two different things. There is the desire and there is the expectation. Desire is what comes from us to them. Expectation is what comes from them to us. So we should always have the desire that everyone we love should also become spiritual. But we shouldn't have that expectation. Especially that expectation shouldn't be a demand. Last week I was in North Carolina, so I gave this whole class on this topic about how the whole mood of the Bhagavad-Gita is that from your place, at your pace, access God's grace. It's from your place. and at your, not at your pace. Everybody will move at their own pace. So we could say there are three things over here. So if we are here, Krishna is here, and our family members are here. So we have our relationship with Krishna, we have our relationship with them, and there is their relationship with Krishna. So often, in trying to develop their relationship with Krishna, we spoil our relationship with them. And when that relationship is spoiled, our relationship with Krishna also gets spoiled. That means we force somebody, do this. And then, if they don't do it, we force them, that what happens is they get alienated from us. And if somebody close to us is alienated from us, that agitates us. Then even if we are chanting, we can't focus on our chanting. So we need to keep first things first. Our relationship with Krishna is extremely important. And we make sure that our basic bhakti practices go on well. Then second is, we need to connect with others better at a human level first. Sometimes we try to make our connection with others only at a spiritual level. But it's important to connect at a human level. Human level means what? That if my family, if our family members see that our bhakti has made us maybe a better mother, a better spouse, a better child, a better sibling, that is what they will say. Prabhupada was asked, how do we know your followers? And Prabhupada said, they are perfect gentlemen and ladies. So the idea is, he didn't say that they wake up in the morning and they chant so many rounds and they follow the four regs. There are so many rules. All that is there. But what does the world care about that? You know, how many rounds you chant? Why do I care? I don't care. So it's saying, don't tell me what you believe. Show me how you behave. So if we connect better with them at a human level, say maybe we were very moody earlier and we become more stabilized. We used to get angry and now we are calmer. Then they will see that change. So we focus on improving the human connection with them. And if the human connection with them is improved, then they themselves, this changes you for the better. Maybe it will change me also for the better. Then they will also try to connect. So we can give them the way. We can open the door for them. But if they don't walk through the door, we don't hold it against them. Everybody has their relationship with Krishna and everybody will move at their pace. So certainly you should have desire, but don't have that expectation. And certainly don't have that demand. So then we will find that actually, even if they do something which we don't like or which upsets us, if we are connected with Krishna, then that connection with Krishna will stabilize us. And actually in that case, our vertical relationship with Krishna will bring greater stability in our horizontal relationship also. That's why it said that we need to be humble and tolerant so that we can chant better. So that chant better means connect with Krishna better. So actually this humility and tolerance is about the horizontal relationship with others. Now, humility and tolerance we already have with Krishna. Krishna is great. No, and if Krishna does something, we have no option, we have to tolerate. Isn't it? So there is not much point we can resent it, but ultimately we can't change it. But with others, we think we can control them. So if what Krishna is telling over here is, in the Trinadapi Sunichena, this verse, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is saying that, we need to make our horizontal relationships as filled with humility and tolerance. Then our vertical relationship with Krishna will go unimpeded. Kirtaniya Sadahari will happen. So try to have the desire, but decrease the expectation from them. Okay? Thank you. Hare Krishna. Any other questions? Yes,
please. Could you please elaborate, you are not able to understand the imprison and the investment in the relationship?
Okay.
Because of why I answered as a Gavastha, for me, is getting attached is natural because it's like kind of going in a sea, swimming and not getting wet.
Okay. So, what is the difference between invested and imprisoned, or difference between attachment and commitment? If we are in family life, isn't it natural that we'll get attached? Like entering into the ocean and not getting wet? Okay. Hey, words can have different connotations at different times. So, we also have to consider the reference point through which particular things are spoken. Say, for example, now the Bhagavatam may talk about how somebody should not be attached to family. And that is because they are living at the level of dharma, they are doing their dharmic responsibilities. But now they have to rise to the level of paradharma. So you could say there are three levels: adharma, dharma, and paradharma. Paradharma is our spiritual connection with Krishna. Dharma is our religiosity in terms of doing the responsibility in this world. Adharma is complete irresponsibility. So, the Bhagavatam is talking about raising people from dharma to paradharma. So, don't be attached to your family. Learn that you only Krishna is your eternal relationship. And focus on the relationship with Krishna also. So, from that context, that is the point that is being spoken. But today, in many cases, actually, people are not even at this level. They are taking up responsibilities. Many people actually just don't want to take up responsibilities. That's why aversion to commitment is not detachment. Nowadays people are very commitment phobic. See, detachment means that, okay, I don't want to enjoy these things. That's detachment. But aversion to commitment is, there are so many things to enjoy, I don't want to lose any of the options. So I'll keep all options open. That is not detachment. So you could say in the mode of ignorance, there is this aversion to commitment. In the mode of goodness, there is commitment. In the mode of passion, there will be attachment. Like in the mode of passion at least, okay, this is what I want to do. This is what I want to enjoy. In ignorance, I'm not even sure what I want to enjoy. In goodness and beyond, okay, this is okay. I've experienced this, but there must be something more in life. So we need to understand where we are. So as you rightly said, that certain amount of investment of emotion in our family is important. That's the way we grow. Otherwise we stay self-absorbed. We won't become Krishna-absorbed. We stay self-absorbed. So it is every relationship forces us to come out of ourselves. So that is good. In the sense that, especially in today's world where people tend to be individualistic, obsessively individualistic. I say that everybody is a I specialist. Not I specialist, I specialist. So it's good to come out of that. But at the same time, we have to understand that, okay, this relationship is important. But why is this important? Because ultimately, this soul is also a part of Krishna. I am also a part of Krishna. So I'm linking with the soul, but I also want to link with Krishna. So that means that there should be affection, but no attachment. And what is the difference again? When we are attached to someone, we are more concerned about their pleasure than their well-being. We're more concerned about their pleasure than their well-being. So, for example, if a child is sick, child has typhoid, the child says, I want to eat fried food. And the child starts crying. And I say, oh, my child is crying. I say, okay, you take this fried food. Now, she's concerned about her pleasure, but what is happening? Not concerned about the welfare. So, we of course don't want to displease anyone. But sometimes, every relationship will require that for the welfare of the other person, we have to do something which we don't want us to do. So, attachment means that whatever they want, we will do it, no matter what the price. What the price for us, price for them, price for our values, our purposes, everything. That is bad. But affection means we care for the person, we care for their emotions, we care for their pleasure, but we also care for their well-being. And ideal is the pleasure and the well-being both can come together. But if it doesn't come, then sometimes we are ready to say no for their pleasure so that we can say yes for their welfare. So that's why it's not rather than worrying about whether we are getting attached in family life, we focus on connecting with Krishna seriously. If you can maintain that connection with Krishna, if you can steadily practice bhakti, then that itself will stabilize us. And whatever inevitable storms will come in that relationship, we will navigate them. So bhakti is not so much a process of giving up as taking up. not giving up our relationship, but taking up the eternal relationship with Krishna. And if you focus on that, just trying to steadily connect with Krishna, then the Dhammi Buddhi Yogam Tam Yenamamapriyantiti. Krishna will give us the intelligence by which you can come to Him. Okay? Thank you. Any other questions? That Krishna will take, Krishna takes away those things that take us away from Him. So Krishna takes away those things that take us away from Him. So sometimes it is in a happy condition that we may worship Krishna with greater focus, and in a distressful condition that becomes difficult to devote us. That's true. See, that's why the important thing is not that distress is the cause of devotion. You know, if distress were the cause of devotion, all the hospitals would be filled with devotees. So actually, it is the conscious decision to turn toward Krishna that will take us toward Him. And it is our responsibility to try to organize life in such a way that distress can be minimized. We say that this world is a place of distress, dukkhalaya. But if you see at the start of the Bhagavad Gita, Arjuna is crying. He is in great distress. Now Krishna doesn't tell Arjuna, this world is dukkhalaya, you are dukkhi, so stay dukkhi. Krishna speaks the whole message of the Bhagavad Gita, and by the end of it, Arjuna has calmed down. Arjuna is sitos nigata sandeha, his emotions have calmed down. So the idea here is that it is our responsibility, our means individually and socially, to arrange society and arrange our lives in such a way that distress can be minimized. So it is true that if there is too much uncertainty, then it becomes difficult to practice bhakti. Say for example, on some days, say once a week, say tomorrow Ekadashi, we fast. And maybe because of that austerity, we think of Krishna. But that is a voluntarily chosen austerity. But suppose we are so poor that we don't have any food on a regular basis. Now that lack of food won't help us remember Krishna. Isn't it? It's occasional deprivation of material necessities can impel us to turn toward Krishna more. But constant deprivation won't necessarily facilitate turning toward God. So we do need to work at a material level also to set things right. But sometimes some things just can't be set right. So then we have to learn to accept that and move on. So it's not that distress itself is a virtue. It is a certain level of material well-being is needed so that we can focus on spirituality. See, like say, all of us are sitting and we are discussing about Krishna. Now, if right now the place where we are sitting, all of it is filled with thorns or nails, then we can't sit comfortably. Or say, I was in New Zealand and suddenly I was giving a class and suddenly everybody seemed to be moving. And I thought I was also moving. What happened? This is an earthquake. Now, I had never been a part of an earthquake before, and everybody was so calm. Said, earthquake. See, earthquakes happen once or twice a week over here. Of course, they are minor earthquakes. So, it is not much, but still, it was unusual. So, you know, if the earth below us is quaking, we cannot focus on any class or anything that. So, we do need a certain level of material stability. And that's why it's not that distress is the producer of devotion. It's rather, it is our conscious desire to turn toward Krishna. And even the Vedic scriptures also, Krishna talks about dharma at two levels. He says, I come to establish dharma in the world. What does it mean? I come to establish social order so that spiritual order can flourish. So we need social order, no doubt about it. Okay?
Thank you. So when Krishna says in Bhagavad-Gītā that four types of people surrender to you, one of them is a distress. So he's doing it consciously. Not because he's distressed or he's faced distress. But like you said, even if you're distressed, you have to face Krishna. But that will be consciously you will face Krishna or turn to Krishna in distress.
Yes, that's true. So is it that even those who turn toward Krishna in distress, they're consciously turning toward them? Yes, that's why Krishna says, Sukrutina. Chaturvidha bhajante ma janaha sukrutino arjuna. Arto jidhyasu ratharthi jnani chivaratarshava. So sukrutina means they have some piety that makes them turn toward God. Other than distress, somebody might turn towards drink, somebody might turn towards adding drugs, somebody might turn towards so many other things in the world. So there is that inclination to turn toward the Lord, definitely. And it is that's what is appreciated. Even if they are turning towards God simply for material things, but this is the turning toward God. So thank you very much. Shri Prabhupada ki
Jai.
Shri Kulshekhar Maharaj ki
Jai.
Shri Mukunda Mala Stotra ki
Jai.
Dai Gaur Premanande.
His Grace Chaitanya Charan Prabhu ki Jai.